It was 1974. It was just kind of the birth of the women's movement. And I had just gone through a divorce, and I was discovering for myself what it was like to not be an auxiliary person. And that was the discovery that I was going through at the time.
Back when I grew up, it was duty, honor, and country, and what your parents expected you to do and what your mentors expected you to do. And it took a lot of courage to go off on your own. I had radical about faces in my life direction. I was definitely striking out on my own and making my own choices. And I could easily identify with a woman who was doing the same thing.
And the idea that a woman could be a person in her own right, of course there were always exceptions, but for the average woman just going through life, getting along and raising her children, this idea that we were primary in our own lives to ourselves was astonishing. And I felt that it was the right story to explore a woman's point of view. It was 1973-74 for Warner Brothers, and John Calley was the head of the studio, and he sent me a message that he would like to do another film with me. And they started sending me all the scripts that they had. And I didn't really like any of them because the scripts that were available, all of the women's parts were the wife, the mother, or the whore. I mean, the three standard roles for women, but they were all in relation to the man. It was the man's story, and then the woman was the assistant. And I kept saying no to Warner Brothers, not that one, not that one. And after they'd sent me and I had read everything that they already had, my agent found Alice Doesn't Live Here Anymore. Wonderful script written by Bob Getchell. We sent the script to Warner Brothers, and they said they really liked it and they wanted to do it. So we then were in business, and John Calley said, who do you want to direct it? And I said, I don't know, somebody new and young and exciting. And I then called Francis Coppola, and I said, I need a director for a film that's new and young and exciting. Who do you know? And he said, well, look at a movie called Mean Streets. So I looked at it, and I was very impressed. And I said to John Calley, I would like that director, Marty Scorsese. And he said, really? Well, let's have a meeting. So he called Marty, and we met in John's office, and in walked this highly charged, wound up, nervous guy. And we sat down, and I said, I saw your film Mean Streets, and I admire it very much. But there really aren't any women in it. And this is a film that I would like told from a woman's point of view. And from your film, I can't tell what you know about women. What do you know about women? And Marty said, nothing, but I'd like to learn. And I said, this is a wise man. I like this guy.
When I read the script for Alice, I really didn't know if I was up to the guy. I certainly didn't have the acting experience that was necessary, probably, you know, just the mechanics of it.
Chris was slightly daunted at times. Chris was young in his film career, and he was still a little self-conscious and not sure what he was doing there.
But I had done a lot of things I've worked on as a laborer in Wake Island, and I'd worked in Alaska on the railroad and firefighting, and 4 years of college, 2 years at Oxford, 5 years in the Army, then 4 years of working to be accepted as a songwriter, a couple of years flying helicopters out in the Gulf of Mexico, and I'd been a lot of things, and I'd done a lot of things. I had done enough things, I felt I could be this guy and not be just an actor up there doing it. When I got the job, Marty said, probably one of the most helpful things that a director ever told me was, he said, don't worry about what it says in the script, like he said sternly, or he said, you know, but he had me go through and cross out all the sort of directorial comments and just leave the dialogue. How would you say that? How would you react to that? And it changed everything for me. I think he knew that I didn't have the confidence that maybe I should have. And he did everything he could to bolster that. He would tell me something nice that somebody said about me, or he'd be over there working away. He'd say, De Niro says blah, 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 blah. You know, you're the best thing doing this, that, and the other. And it worked. He was able to deal with a lot of the inexperienced people.
Hey, Tommy, don't use your fingernails. You kick that bucket over.
Okay.
Oh, very funny.
Alfred Lutter was an unknown actor, but nothing daunted Alfred. Alfred was a very secure little boy who was very much like the boy in the story, meaning brilliant and annoying.
Are we there yet?
Alfred was a kid, you know, at the time, and he, all day long, he was playing a brat, you know, a kid who gets on everybody's nerves, and it's hard to turn it off if you're an adult, but he never turned it off.
Shoot the dog! Shoot the dog! Shoot the dog!
But did you get it?
The shoot the dog story was, we were staying about an hour from where we were shooting, the location where we were shooting, and Marty rode in the van with Alfred Lutter. And he told that story to Marty all the way for a whole hour on the way to the set. And he kept doing it. Shoot the dog, shoot the dog.
Shoot the dog, shoot the dog, shoot the dog.
Do you get it? Marty would say, yes. And what? What is it? I don't know. Okay, and then you'd tell it again.
And there'd be Marty. I'd just see his silhouette sitting up there listening to this thing in his ear.
He has to know that to get the punchline.
Uh-huh.
Now, do you know what nuts are?
And by the time Marty got to the set, he was just totally worn down by the story, but thought it was hilarious and put it in the movie.
Then what's the joke?
I don't know.
All right, then I'm going to tell it to you again.
Alfred and I kind of identified with each other, I think, because we were both the rookies in there.
Shoot the dog! Hey, didn't you get it?
We gave each other moral support when the camera wasn't running.
Billy Greenbush, I must say, he's a very wonderful, unique actor.
But I'm gonna save it for you. When you get back, you're gonna drink it. See how you like it.
A husband with that edge can be pretty frightening.
Thomas, if you'd show a little respect around here, just may rub off on him.
There's an element of danger that I think a lot of women feel with a lot of men. I think Billy really expressed it, and Harvey did too.
Open the door!
I was not prepared for how scary he could be.
God damn it, Alice, don't tell me
what... The look on Ellen's face was like somebody you'd read about the next day in the papers, you know, and it was terrifying.
I'll bust your jaw!
I don't think I've seen a more pure victim on a screen.
You don't mess around with it, and it ain't gonna mess around with you. You mess around with it, and it's gonna kill you. All right, sweetheart.
Uh-huh. I remember afterwards, after the scene was over, after we finished shooting, I had a sort of meltdown. I just cried for a couple of hours. It was just like a release.
I'm all right.
It felt to me, if you were to describe David's character in the whole thing compared to like the other men in her life or anything, he was a rock. And that's the way I played it, like that scene in the kitchen, where she's performing for him and telling these old stories and everything, and he's just looking at her, he's just absolutely charmed by this creature who's unlike anything in his experience, you know. I said, I'm the maypole, and you're the person that dances around it, you know.
And then they would laugh again, so then we'd do it on the other side, right?
That's hell of an act.
Marty has enormous creative energy. And I think what seems like nervousness in him is really just a massive amount of creative energy running through him all the time. It made me feel creative, too. And that's what Marty does on the set. Everybody gets turned on. It was my desire to do that film. So I was a kind of initiatory impulse, but I released the control of the film to Marty's artistry. And he directed the cinematic expression of that story. It's so a picture of that time, you know, an image of that period. It was people behaving the way people behave, as we know them to be, not as Hollywood usually presents them to be. And that was something that interested me. And Marty's work, it seemed, was exemplifying reality as opposed to fantasy.
I have my little boy I have to raise all by myself, and I don't know how I'm going to do it.
I don't even have a piano in here.
I think all of Marty's films have a gritty feel to them. You know, they feel like the real thing. And if it didn't have that gritty feel, it would have been just a corny story. You know, it would have looked sappy and cliched to me. But it didn't go over into that. You know, it was you believed the characters. There's a lot of really real scenes in that film.
Shit kicking.
I remember being very uncomfortable during that whole scene, and that, which is good, because that's what the guy was. He was uncomfortable about it. It scared me, because it kind of hurt him, you know, and I think it scared him too, when I had to give him a swat, and boy, it turned her loose like a lion, you know.
Why should he? All you do is criticize him.
I played it just as he was unable to react any other way when he was attacked.
That kid thinks he can do whatever he wants to do, whenever he wants to do it, and wherever he wants to do it.
Yeah, well, so do you. You're just as selfish as he is. You want what you want when you want it. I really don't think you understand kids at all.
At the time, I had two children that were in the family that I'd lost along the way, you know, in my struggle to be whatever I was being at the time. And I had a lot of guilty feelings. So the scene it was hard for me to be hard on him.
I always wanted the viewer to be looking at this story from Alice's point of view. I wanted them to be looking through her eyes. And so then I asked myself, when does a man look sexy to a woman? I thought, it seems to me that the times that I really experienced that, being turned on by a man, just looking at him and watching him, it was when he was working with his hands. I suggested that to Marty, that we find the moment when Alice falls in love with David is a moment when he's working and enjoying looking at his body.
I felt that she was looking at me like a man, and it was the first time that we really connected, and probably made the rest of it easy, because what we were saying didn't matter as much as just what was going down.
You know what a little turkey does when it rains? Put their head back and open up their mouth and drown.
And it was done in a real simple, tender way. It was the truth, because I could really believe that those two people connected.
I remember the wind was blowing that day, and it was whipping my hair around. And the camera operator came up to me afterwards, and he said, "You should always do your love scenes in a high wind." I said, "Why?" And he said, "I don't know, it does something to you."
He's dealing with so many insane things, you know, that a director like he is shouldn't have to deal with.
Oh, hold him in.
We shot in this ranch, and the people who lived there moved out for however long we were shooting there. But it came time for us to be finished and to leave there, and the couple to move back into their house, and we weren't finished. And we negotiated, I mean, they did, to stay longer, and the couple said, "No, we want to come home." So it came down to Friday night, the last day we could be in this house, and we had to get all of the scenes. And toward the end, the couple came into the house, and they were sitting in the living room as we would do a take. And then Marty would say, cut, okay, we go again. And the people would go, what was the matter with that one? That was fine. Why don't you print that one?
Right. It was the most unusual thing. Well, that's why you got to laugh at Marty.
And Marty at one point turned to me and said, has anybody ever made a movie like this?
he keeps control.
I'd like you and Tommy to come out to place. Please.
We had a big fight with the studio because they wanted her and the Chris character to get married. And I kept saying, she's got to be able to, the whole point is that she's standing on her own and she's got to go to Monterey. And I had this fight with John Kelly, my friend. No, she has to marry the guy at the end. It has to have a happy ending.
God damn it, Alice, I said, please.
I said, wait a minute here. If she ends up with a man, it's a happy ending. And if she goes on to Monterey by herself, it's an unhappy ending. He said, yeah, that's what I'm saying to you.
I want to sing. I want to be a singer. I am a singer. And anything I do from now on has got to include that.
But then we had to figure out how we could make this movie about a woman finding her independence and end up marrying the man. And we didn't know what we were going to do. We got right up to the day before we were shooting the scene. We still didn't have it. And then all of a sudden, Chris, in the middle of a improvisation, said,
geez, if he loves this girl, you know, if I did, I'd just say, pack your bags. I'll go with you.
And I said, you will? He said,
but I don't care about the damn ranch.
And I turned to Marty, and Marty looked at me, and we said, why don't we ever think of that?
Who's stopping you? Pack your bags. I'll take you to Monterey. I don't give a damn about that ranch.
And Ellen just melted to it. she says, oh, I like it. Yeah.
Of course. She ends up with the man, and she goes to Monterey. You know, when we did it, I said, Marty, you want these people to applaud? And he said, yeah, the studio wants a theatrical ending, so let's make it theatrical.
Now, the first thing you gotta do is figure out what it is you want. And once you figure it out, you just jump in there with both feet and let the devil take the hindmost.
The point was to have Alice go through the transformation that so many of us women were going through at the time. To start out in the place of the wife who was there to assist the husband, and then for whatever reason, in Alice's case it was the death of her husband, in my case it was the divorce, to be on her own and to discover a sense of self, that there was more to life than planning dinner and doing the dishes afterwards. Perhaps she could be living her life that was meaningful to her, and then taking pride in the tip she got and the responsibility she was taking, taking care of her son, and it was working out.
It's right next door. I can walk to work. We'll always have food to eat, and I'll earn enough money to get us to Monterey.
Well, that's sort of life, isn't it? Survival is victory. Victories come fewer and farther between the longer into life as you go, you know. But surviving can feel like a victory.
But it's my life, you know, my life. It's not some man's life that I'm going to help him out with.
No, ma'am.
It was a very personal story. It was what I was going through at the time. It was what all of us were involved in that particular period. It was an awakening, but it was an individual person's awakening.
My boy.
Mom, I can't breathe.